Hello everyone, today we'll discuss about the muscles of the lower limb and in the part 2 especially about the gluteal and the sole muscles. Now first of all, the gluteal muscles. Now the gluteal muscle, the superficial muscle is the of course gluteus maximus muscle, and behind this gluteus maximus muscle, half of the gluteus medius muscle actually hidden. So you can see the gluteus medius muscle without removing the gluteus maximus, but only half of the gluteus medius. If you want to see the full gluteus medius, you have to remove the gluteus maximus muscle. And when we remove this gluteus maximus and the gluteus medius muscle, we will be able to see the further muscle. That is, first of all, the gluteus minimus muscle. Now I suggest you to remember in the series, okay, from above to downwards. So it will be easier for you to remember all the muscles of the particular gluteal region, and it will be easily able to identify the particular muscles in your exam. Okay, so first of all, from above to downward, first of all, we have the topmost one is the gluteus minimus muscle after removing the maximus and the medius muscle of the gluteal region. Okay, so first of all, we have the gluteus minimus muscle, topmost one, then the piriformis muscle, then the superior jamilis, or we can superior jamuli, then the obturator internus muscle, then the inferior jamuli, then the caudatus femoris muscle. Okay, and we have also the obturator externus muscle, but this obturator externus muscle actually present close to the obturator foramen of the particular pelvis bone, right? So over here, that's why it is not visible over here, because it present close to the obturator foramen and very attached closely to the obturator membrane. Okay, and so over here it is not visible. Over here we have the tensor fascia lata also. So remember, in the series, gluteus maximus and medius in the superficial part, and when we remove this in the series from above to downward, we have the minimus, gluteus minimus, then piriformis, superior jamuli, obturator internus, inferior jamuli, then the this caudatus femoris, and when we remove all this, obturator externus muscle, and then finally at the downward direction we have the tensor fascia lata, which actually lies between the gluteal region and the front of the thigh. Now first of all, the gluteus maximus muscle origin. Now this muscle originates from the posterior part of the sacrum bone, posterior iliac crest, and the superior gluteal line of the ilium. Now this muscle has many origin areas, okay, but the main are these, you can remember over here, the posterior sacrum, posterior iliac crest, and the superior gluteal line of the ilium bone. Okay, now next is the insertion, basically at the gluteal tuberosity of the femur and also the iliotibial band, or we can say the iliotibial tract. So remember over here, the greater part of this muscle is inserted into the iliotibial tract, and the deep fibers of this particular muscle are inserted into the gluteal tuberosity over here. Very important. Now over here, the innervation, over here, this muscle basically innervated by the inferior gluteal nerve L5S1S2. Now this muscle basically innervated by the inferior gluteal nerve L5S1S2. And very important, the action of this muscle, mostly asked question. Now this muscle is actually chief extension of the thigh at the hip joint. Chief extension of the thigh at the hip joint. And this action, means extension of the thigh at the hip joint, is very important in rising from a sitting position. So whenever you are rising from a sitting position, your particularly gluteus maximus muscle is acting. Okay, and this is very essential for maintaining the erect posture of your body. And very important other action of this muscle are the lateral rotation of the thigh, abduction of the thigh, and also along with the tensor fascia lata, the gluteus maximus muscle which stabilizes the knee through the iliotibial tract. Because if you remember, this particular gluteus maximus muscle is the greater part of this muscle is basically inserted onto the iliotibial tract. So that's why, along with the tensor fascia lata, this muscle stabilizes the knee through the iliotibial tract. Now also, this muscle supports both the hip and the knee joint when these joints are slightly flexed. And also, very important thing, this is an anti-gravity muscle. Okay, anti-gravity muscle. Now next is the gluteus medius muscle. Now this muscle basically originates from the gluteal surface of the ilium between the anterior and the posterior gluteal line, and inserts into the greater trochanter of the femur bone on the oblique ridge on the lateral surface. Now this gluteal medius muscle is supplied by the superior gluteal nerve, L4, L5, S1. And remember, the gluteus medius along with the gluteus minimus muscle actually acts as a very powerful abductor of the thigh at the hip joint. And the anterior fibers of these muscles actually act as a very powerful medial rotators. Okay, and very important thing is that whenever your opposite foot is off the ground, okay, so suppose your left foot is off the ground, okay, and so at that time your right gluteus medius and the minimus muscle will act over there and stabilize your body weight, okay, and they do this by preventing the opposite side of the pelvis from tilting downwards under the influence of the gravity. So we can say that even these are also anti-gravity muscle apart from the gluteus maximus. But remember, gluteus maximus is the main anti-gravity muscles. Okay, but by over here, by this way that the it basically stabilizes the body when opposite foot is off the ground, we can say that these are also one kind of anti-gravity muscles only. And also remember that these gluteus medius and gluteus minimus muscle, when get paralyzed, so what will happen? Lurching gaits and the waddling gait may cause, because over here there is no stability given to the particular body by the medius and the minimus muscle. Now next is the gluteus minimus muscle. Now this muscle basically originates from the gluteal surface of the ilium between the anterior and the inferior gluteal lines and inserts basically into the greater trochanter of the femur on a ridge on its anterior surface. Now supply same as of the gluteus medius, that is the superior gluteal nerve, L4, L5, S1, and same function as that of the we discussed previously. Now next is the piriformis muscle. Now this piriformis muscle basically arises within the pelvis from two areas, that means from the pelvic surface of the middle three pieces of the sacrum by three digitations, and also from the upper margin of the greater sciatic notch. Okay. And inserts basically at the apex of the greater trochanter of the femur bone and supplied by the ventral rami of the S1 and S2. And the main function of this piriformis is the lateral rotation of the thigh at the hip joint. Now next is the superior jamuli and the inferior jamuli. So first of all, superior jamuli originate from the upper part of the lesser sciatic notch, while the inferior jamuli originates from the lower part of the lesser sciatic notch. And the superior and the inferior jamuli both inserts at the same location, that is at the medial surface of the greater trochanter of the femur. Now you remember that these two muscles don't have same nerve supply. The nerve supply of the superior jamuli is the nerve to obturator internus, L5, S1, S2. And for the inferior jamuli, the nerve supply is the nerve to quadratus femoris. Okay, L4, L5, S1. Now how to remember this nerve supply? So just remember, if you remember that I told you previously that you have to remember the particular muscles of the gluteal region in the series from upper, from top to bottom. Okay, and if you remember, there were piriformis, then superior jamuli, then the obturator internus, then inferior jamuli, and then the quadratus femoris, right? So just remember that two things are together, okay, so they would be having the same nerve supply. So superior jamuli and the obturator internus muscle are together, and so they will be having the same nerve supply, means nerve to obturator internus, while the inferior jamuli and the quadratus femoris are together, and so they will be having the same nerve supply, that means the nerve to quadratus femoris. Okay, so by this you can remember that these two don't have the same nerve supply, but they have the nerve supply same as the muscle near to them. Okay, now action of these two are same, that is the lateral rotation of the thigh at the hip joint. Now next is about the obturator internus muscle. Now this muscle basically originates from the pelvic surface of the obturator membrane and also from the pelvic surface of the body of the ischium, ischial tuberosity, ischiopubic rami, and also from the ilium below the pelvic brim. Now this muscle basically inserts at the medial surface of the greater trochanter of the femur. And again, the nerve supply, if you remember, told you that the superior jamuli and the obturator internus would be having the same nerve supply because they are near to each other. Okay, and so nerve to obturator internus, okay, having the root value as L5, S1, S2. Okay, and the action same, lateral rotation of the thigh at the hip joint. Next is the obturator externus muscle. Now this muscle basically originates from the outer surface of the obturator membrane. Okay, so remember, from the pelvic surface of the obturator membrane, obturator internus, and from the outer surface of this membrane, obturator externus, and also on the outer surface of the bony margin of the obturator foramen. Now insertion basically at the trochanteric fossa on the medial side of the gear trochanter, and nerve supply. Nerve supply is basically the posterior division of the obturator nerve L2, L3 and L4, and same action lateral rotation of the thigh at the hip joint. Now the corridus femoris, over here this muscle basically originates from the upper part of the outer border of the ischial tuberosity and inserts at the quadrate tubercle and the area below it. The nerve supply, if you remember, same as that of the inferior jamuli, that is the nerve to corridus femoris, because they are close to each other. L4, L5, S1. And action, same lateral rotation of the thigh at the hip joint. So now remember, in short, the piriformis, superior jamuli, obturator internus, inferior jamuli, corridus femoris, and the obturator externus muscle, these all six muscles have the same action, that of the lateral rotation of the thigh at the hip joint. Okay. Now next is the tensor fasciae lata. Now this muscle is basically present between the gluteal region and the front of the thigh and arises anterior 5 cm of the outer lip of the iliac crest up to the tubercle of the iliac crest and inserts at the iliotibial tract 3 to 5 cm below the level of the gear trochanter of the femur. And the nerve supply is the superior gluteal nerve. Okay. And action is basically the abduction and the medial rotation of the thigh and also extension of the knee joint. Now next are the very important and the complex muscle group, that is the sole muscle. Now the sole muscle basically divided into four layers, means first, second, third and fourth layers. So first of all, the first layer, remember we have three main muscles, that is the abductor hallucis, flexor digitorum brevis and the abductor digiti minimi. So first of all, the abductor hallucis muscle. Now this muscle basically originates from the medial tubercle of the calcaneum bone, also from the flexor retinaculum and also from the medial intermuscular septum. Just remember over here, the main origin of the abductor hallucis is basically at the medial tubercle of the calcaneum bone. Just remember this one, this is the main important one. Also remember the insertion over here, the tendon of this particular muscle fuses with the medial portion of the tendon of the flexor hallucis brevis, and after this particular fusion of these two tendon or these two muscles, they basically inserts at the medial side of the base of the proximal phalanx of the greater toe. So remember, whenever you see the particular word hallucis, that means over here the toe will be come into picture. Okay. Nerve supply. Now this muscle is supplied by the medial plantar nerve. Remember the medial plantar nerve, and this muscle basically abducts the greater toe away from the second toe, because as the name says, abductor hallucis means abducts the hallucis, that means abducts the greater toe. Now next is about the flexor digitorum brevis or FDB. Now this FDB basically originates from the medial tubercle of the calcaneum. Now remember, these muscle basically inserts by dividing into four tendons for the lateral four toes, and opposite the base of the proximal phalanx, each of these tendon divides into two slips that are basically inserted into the margin of the middle phalanx. Okay. Now nerve supply. This FDB is supplied by the medial plantar nerve, and over here this basically causes the flexion of the toes at the proximal interphalangeal joint and the metatarsophalangeal joints. Now next is about the abductor digiti minimi or ADM. Now this abductor digiti minimi basically originates from the medial and the lateral tubercle of the calcaneum. Now this muscle basically inserts into the lateral side of the base of the proximal phalanx of the little toe. And remember, these muscle tendon will actually fuse with the tendon of the flexor digiti minimi brevis. Okay. And if you remember that this abductor hallucis basically fuses with the tendon of the flexor hallucis brevis, while the abductor digiti minimi tendon will actually fuse with the flexor digiti minimi brevis muscle tendon. Okay, inserts at the lateral side of the base of the proximal phalanx of the little toe. Nerve supply. Now this muscle is supplied by the main trunk of the lateral plantar nerve. And this muscle basically causes the abduction of the little toe. The name is abductor digiti minimi. That means the abduction of the little toe. Now next is the second layer, that is the we have over here two tendons and two muscles. First of all, two tendons over here are the flexor hallucis longus and the flexor digitorum longus, and two muscles over here are the flexor digitorum accessorius and four lumbrical muscles. Now first of all, the flexor digitorum longus over here. Now this muscle basically originates from the upper two-thirds of the medial part of the posterior surface of the tibia below the soleal line, and inserts basically by dividing into four tendons, and each tendon inserted at the plantar surface of the distal phalanx of second to fifth toe. Okay, just remember the diagram. Okay, so you'll be easily able to remember the origin insertion because we have so many muscles over here. So just remember the diagram over here. Try to memorize more and more about the diagram structure. Okay, now next is about the nerve supply. Now this FDL actually gets innervated by the tibial nerve, and the action over here is the plantar flexion of the lateral four toes, plantar flexion of the ankle, and also it basically maintains the medial longitudinal arch. Now next is the flexor hallucis longus. Now this muscle basically originates from the lower 3/4 of the posterior surface of the fibula bone and inserts at the plantar surface of the base of the distal phalanx of the great toe, and supplied by the tibial nerve. And over here the action of this muscle is to plantar flex the big toe, and also plantar flexion of the ankle joint, and maintains a medial longitudinal arch. Okay, now next muscle is the two muscles. Okay, first of all, we had the two tendons. Now we will discuss about two muscles. Now first of all, the flexor digitorum accessorius. Now this muscle basically originates from the by two heads, remember, the medial and the lateral head. So medial head is large and fleshy and arises from the medial concave surface of the calcaneum bone, and the lateral head is smaller and tendinous and arises from the calcaneum in front of the lateral tubercle. Okay, and inserts basically at the common insertion area, that means at the lateral side of the tendon of the flexor digitorum longus. Now nerve supply of this muscle is the main trunk of lateral plantar nerve, and this muscle basically straightens the pull of the long flexor tendons and flexes the toe through the long tendon. So remember, it actually straightens the pull of the long flexor tendons and flexes the toe through the long tendons. Now the four lumbrical muscles. Now the four lumbricals basically arises from the tendon of the flexor digitorum longus. The first lumbrical is unipinnate and others are bipinnate, as you can see. Okay, the first lumbrical arises from the medial side of the first tendon of the FDL. Second lumbrical from the adjacent side of the first and the second tendon of the FDL. Third lumbrical arising from the adjacent side of the second and third tendon of the FDL. And the fourth from the adjacent side of the third and fourth tendon of the FDL. Okay, and the insertion over here is the common area, that means into the extensor expansion. The nerve supply. Now the first over here, the first lumbrical or the first muscle supplied by the medial plantar nerve, and the other three by the deep branch of the lateral plantar nerve. First by the medial plantar nerve and the rest by the lateral plantar nerve. Okay, and the function of this muscle is to maintain the extension of the digits, and basically the extension is actually maintained at the interphalangeal joint, so that in walking and the running process, the toes do not buckle under. Now next, the third layer. In the third layer, we have basically three muscles. There is the flexor hallucis brevis, adductor hallucis, and the flexor digiti minimi brevis. Okay, so first of all, the flexor hallucis brevis. Now this muscle basically having a Y-shaped tendon origin. Okay, this muscle basically arises by a Y-shaped tendon. Okay, first of all, the Y-shaped tendon, lateral limb. Okay, lateral limb of this Y-shaped tendon originates from the medial part of the plantar surface of the cuboid bone, and also on the adjacent side of the lateral cuneiform bone. And the medial limb of this Y-shaped tendon is a direct continuation of the tendon of the tibialis posterior into the foot. Okay, the nerve supply over here is the medial plantar nerve. And the actions over here are the flexion of the proximal phalanx at the metatarsophalangeal joint of the great toe. Now next is the adductor hallucis muscle. Now this muscle is actually having two heads of origin, that is the oblique head and the transverse head. The oblique head of this muscle is actually large and arises from the base of the second, third and fourth metatarsal bones. Okay, and the transverse head is actually small and arises from the deep metatarsal ligament and the plantar ligament of the metatarsophalangeal joints of the third, fourth and fifth toes. And by this we can say that the transverse head of the adductor hallucis muscle is having no bony origin. Okay. The nerve supply is the deep branch of lateral plantar nerve which terminates in this muscle only. And remember, this muscle basically helps in the adduction of the great toe towards the second toe and maintaining the transverse arches of the foot. Now next is about the flexor digiti minimi brevis. Now this muscle basically originates from the base of the fifth metatarsal bone and inserts into the lateral side of the base of the proximal phalanx of the little toe. And the nerve supply over here is the superficial branch of the lateral plantar nerve and basically flexes the proximal phalanx at the metatarsophalangeal joint of the little toe. Now next are the fourth layer sole muscle. That is, first of all we have the two tendon and two muscles over here, that is the tibialis posterior and the peroneus longus tendon, and the three plantar interossei, the four dorsal interossei muscles. Okay, first of all the tibialis posterior tendon. Now this tendon basically originates from the posterior surface of the leg bones, and also it will insert at the tuberosity of the navicular bone, or we can say navicular tuberosity. Now the nerve supply over here, remember the tibial nerve supplies this tendon, and it basically flexes, or we can say plantar flexion of the ankle is actually done by this particular muscle, plantar flexion of the ankle. Now next is about the peroneus longus. Now this muscle is actually originating from the upper part of the lateral surface of the fibula and inserts at the base of the first metatarsal bone. Nerve supply, superficial peroneal nerve, and action is basically the evertor of the foot. Remember, evertor of the foot. Now next is the three plantar interossei muscle. Now this muscle basically originates from the basis and the medial side of the third, fourth and fifth metatarsal bone and inserts at the medial side of the base of the proximal phalanges and the dorsal digital expansion, because the extension expansion of the third, fourth and fifth toes. And remember, the nerve supply over here is, remember the first and the second plantar interossei, we have three plantar interossei, so first and the second are innervated by the lateral plantar nerve and the third one by the lateral plantar nerve only. But remember, the first and second by the lateral plantar nerve deep branch and the third one by the lateral plantar nerve superficial branch. Okay, now we have the action over here. The adduction of the third, fourth and fifth toes towards the axis is basically done by the plantar interossei, and also they do the flexion of the metatarsophalangeal joint and the extension of the interphalangeal joint of the third, fourth and fifth toes. So remember, adduction of the third, fourth and fifth toes and the flexion of the metatarsophalangeal joint and the extension of the interphalangeal joint of the third, fourth and fifth toes. Just remember the location of this particular muscle. You can imagine the particular action they will do. Now next is the four dorsal interossei muscle. Now this muscle basically originates from the adjacent sides of the metatarsal bones. Okay, and inserts basically at the base of the proximal phalanges and dorsal digital expansion of the toes. The first dorsal interossei basically inserts on the medial side of the second toe, second on the lateral side of the second toe, third on the lateral side of the third toe, and the fourth on the lateral side of the fourth toe. Okay, now this was basically innervated by, remember again, the first, second and third by the lateral plantar, and that to the deep branch of the lateral plantar nerve. And the fourth muscle, or the fourth dorsal interossei muscle, by the superficial branch of the lateral plantar nerve. So over here, don't confuse between the plantar interossei and the dorsal interossei. Remember, the first and the second plantar interossei supplied by the deep branch of the lateral plantar nerve and the third by the superficial branch of the lateral plantar nerve. While the dorsal interossei, the first, second and third by the lateral plantar nerve deep branch and the fourth by the lateral plantar nerve superficial branch. And over here, the action of this muscle, basically the abduction of the toes from the axis of the second toe. The first and the second dorsal interossei basically causes the medial and the lateral abduction of the second toe. The third and the fourth basically do the abduction of the third and fourth toes. So this was about the muscles of the gluteal region and the sole muscle. I hope you understood well. Thank you so much.